Antony and Cleopatra by William Shakespeare. Introduced by Richard Eyre.
Antony and Cleopatra is Shakespeare's most luxuriant tragedy. The action sprawls around the Mediterranean as it gives historical form to the mythical encounter between Venus, the god of love, and Mars, the god of war. The play is structured upon a series of oppositions, female and male, desire and duty, age and youth, and above all, Egypt and Rome. "Nay, but this dotage of our general o'erflows the measure," says a Roman soldier in the very opening line. Mark Antony does indeed dote on Cleopatra. From the Roman point of view, it's a monstrous embarrassment that one of the three men who rule their great empire should be disporting himself like an infatuated teenager. Perhaps he's indeed entering his dotage, approaching the second childhood of old age. But from the Egyptian point of view, the power of desire is something that transcends the petty world of tribal politics. The love of Antony and Cleopatra does find out new heaven, new earth. Just as the opening line of the play overflows into the next, so the liquid imagery of Egypt, with the River Nile at its heart, overcomes the measured rigidity of Rome. At the end of the drama, that rigidity prevails, and young Octavius Caesar is left in sole charge of the empire. But all the poetry of the play has been inspired by the Egyptian side. From Enobarbus' entranced memory of Cleopatra's barge, to her final enrobing for the serpent's kiss of death, the language which Cleopatra inspires works its powerful magic upon the listener. Theatre's power to create illusion is of a piece with Cleopatra's seductive arts.
But this dotage of our generals o'erflows the measure. Those his goodly eyes that o'er the files and musters of the war have glowed like plated Mars, now bend, now turn the office and devotion of their view upon a tawny front. His captain's heart, which in the scuffles of great fights hath burst the buckles on his breast, reneges all temper, and is become the bellows and the fan to cool a gypsy's lust. Look where they come. Take but good note, and you shall see in him the triple pillar of the world transformed into a strumpet's fool. Behold and see.
If it be love indeed, tell me how much.
There's beggary in the love that can be reckoned.
How set a born how far to be beloved.
Then must thou needs find out new heaven, new earth.
News, my good lord, from Rome.
Greets me some.
Nay, hear them, Antony. Fulvia, perchance, is angry. Or who knows if the scarce-bearded Caesar hath not sent his powerful mandate to you. Do this or this, take in that kingdom and enfranchise that, performed, or else we damn thee.
How, my love?
Perchance? Nay, and most like. You must not stay here longer. Your dismission is come from Caesar, therefore hear it, Antony. Where's Fulvia's process? Caesar's, I would say. Both. Call in the messengers. As I am Egypt's queen, thou blushest, Antony, and that blood of thine is Caesar's ometra. Else so thy cheek pays shame when shrill-tongued Fulvius goes. The messengers!
Let Rome and Tiber melt, and the wide arch of the ranged empire fall. Here is my space. Kingdoms are clay. Our dungy earth alike feeds beast as man. The nobleness of life is to do thus. And such a mutual pair, and such a twain can do it, in which I bind on pain of punishment the world to wheat. We stand up peerless.
Excellent falsehood. Why did he marry Fulvia and not love her? I'll seem the fool I am not. Antony will be himself.
But stirred by Cleopatra. Now for the love of love and her soft hours. Let's not confound the time with conference harsh. There's not a minute of our lives should stretch without some pleasure now. What sport tonight?
Hear the ambassador.
Fie, wrangling queen, whom everything becomes, to chide, to laugh, to weep. How every passion fully strives to make itself in thee fair and admired. No messenger but thine, and all alone tonight we'll wander through the streets and note the qualities of people. Come, my queen. Last night you did desire it. Speak not to us!
Is Caesar with Antonius prized so slight?
Sir, sometimes when he is not Antony, he comes too short of that great property which still should go with Antony.
I am full sorry that he approves the common liar who thus speaks of him at Rome, but I will hope of better deeds tomorrow. Rest you happy.
Alexis.
Charmian.
Lord Alexis. Sweet Alexis. Most anything Alexis. Almost most absolute Alexis. Where's the soothsayer that you praise so to the queen? Oh, that I knew this husband which you say must charge his horns with garlands.
Soothsayer, your will.
Oh, is this the man? Is it you, sir, that know things?
Nature's infinite book of secrecy. A little I can read.
Show him your hand.
Bring in the banquet quickly. Wine enough. Cleopatra's health to drink.
There, good sir, give me good fortune.
I make not, but foresee.
Oh, pray then, foresee me one.
You shall be yet far fairer than you are.
He means in flesh.
No, you shall paint when you are old.
Oh, wrinkles forbid.
Beg not his prescience. Be attentive.
Hush.
You shall be more beloving than beloved.
Look, I'd rather heat my liver with drinking.
May hear him.
Good now, some excellent fortune. Let me be married to 3 kings in a forenoon and widow them all. Let me have a child at 50 to whom Herod of Jewry may do homage. And bind me to marry me with Octavius Caesar and companion me with my mistress.
You shall outlive the lady whom you serve.
Oh, excellent. I love long life better than figs.
You have seen and proved a fairer form of fortune than that which is to approach.
Then belike my children shall have no names. Prithee, how many boys and wenches must I have?
If every of your wishes had a womb, and fertile every wish, 1,000,000.
Out, fool! I forgive thee for a witch.
You think none but your sheets are privy to your wishes.
Nay, come, tell Iris hers.
We'll know all our fortunes.
Mine, and most of our fortunes tonight, shall be drunk to bed.
There's a palm presages chastity, if nothing else.
Lean as the overflowing Nilus presageth famine.
Go, you wild bedfellow, you cannot soothsay.
Nay, if an oily palm be not a fruitful prognostication, I cannot scratch mine ear. Prithee, tell her but a worky day fortune.
Your fortunes are alike.
But how? But how? Give me particulars.
I have said.
Am I not an inch of fortune better than she?
Well, if you were but an inch of fortune better than I, where would you choose it?
Not in my husband's nose.
Ah, worse thoughts heaven's meant. Alexis, come, his fortune, his fortune. Oh, let him marry a woman that cannot go, sweet Isis, I beseech thee, and let her die too, and give him a worse, and let worse follow worse, till the worst of all follow him laughing to his grave, 50-fold a cuckold. Good Isis, hear me this prayer, though thou deny me a matter of more weight. Good Isis, I beseech thee.
Amen, dear goddess. Hear that prayer of the people. For as it is a heartbreaking to see a handsome man loose wide, so it is a deadly sorrow to behold a foul knave uncuckolded. Therefore, dear Isis, keep decorum and fortune him accordingly.
Amen.
Hush, here comes Antony.
Not he, the queen.
Saw you, my lord?
No, lady.
Was he not here?
No, madam.
He was disposed to mirth, but on the sudden a Roman thought had struck him. Enobarbus.
Madam.
Seek him and bring him hither. Where's Alexis?
Here at your service. My lord approaches.
We will not look upon him. Go with us.
Fulvia, thy wife, first came into the field.
Against my brother Lucius.
Aye, but soon that war had end,
and the time state made friends of them, jointing their force against Caesar, whose better issue...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.